you serve a faithful King. Would you lift up a shout of praise on this room today? He's faithful. Come on, he's faithful. He's faithful. He's faithful. He's faithful. He's faithful. He doesn't change. He's consistent. He doesn't change. He's consistent.
Ocean, so I wouldn't drown. I know. that we can come into his presence and give him the glory that he deserves. We just want to lift our hands, lift our voices to the Lord as I open in prayer today. We just want to give God glory. We thank you, Father God, for another Sunday, Father God. We give you the praise, the honor, and the glory, Father God, for just keeping us to see another week, Father God. Allowing us, Father God, to be here today, Father God, amongst each other. We pray, Father God, that your presence, Father God, will be felt in this building today, Father God. We ask, Father God, that in this moment, Father God, that you would be lifted high, Father God. That you, Father God, would be glorified, Father God. That we, Father God, would incline our hearts to you, Father God. And let our desires be matched with your desires, Father God. We pray that in this moment, Father God, that we would find the confidence that to know, Father God, our identity is found in you, Father God. That we don't have to turn to the left or the right, but we can turn to you, Father God, to know who we are, Father God, that you have called us enough, Father God. We pray, Father God, today, Father God, that you would be with us, that you, Father God, would walk with us, that you, Father God, would speak through us, Father God, and that we would be instruments of your glory, Father God. We pray, Father God, today, Father God, that you would be lifted high, Father God, that we, Father God, would continue to walk with you, that we would be strengthened by you, Father God, and that the youth of this generation would find confidence in you, that they would not be depressed, Father God, that they would not be anxious, Father God, but they would know who they are in you, Father God. We pray, Father God, for the families, Father God, that they would be strengthened, Father God. We pray, Father God, for all the loved ones, Father God, that they will come to get to know you, Father God. We pray, Father God, for this neighborhood. We pray for this community, Father God, that there will be a revival, Father God. We pray, Father God, that your presence will be felt through God's battalion of prayer today, Father God, and that your word will go out, Father God. We pray for the musicians, Father God. We pray for the worshipers. We pray for the stream team. We lift up pastor in this moment, Father God. We ask that you would use your word, Father God, that the people may feel your presence today, Father God. We give you the glory, the honor, and the praise, knowing that you are doing something new, that you are moving, Father God, that your presence, Father God, will be felt today. We pray, Father God, on this Sunday morning, Father God, on this Sunday morning, Father God, that we would not turn to the left or to the right, but we would turn to you, keeping our hearts inclined to you, Father God. We give you the glory, the honor, and the praise, lifting your name above all other names, Father God. In Jesus' name, amen.
I don't know about you, but just this week alone was very trying. But I'm here, and I give God the praise and all the glory and all the honor, for it is due to him. Amen.
He who abides in me will forever be fruitful indeed. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one gets to the Father except that he comes through me. Yeah. So let not forsake you. Let not mercy and truth sing. Forsake you. Write them on. We will write them on tablets of
Stay right here.
can build your home on my worship. I'll stay right here where I'm welcomed. You can build your home on my worship. I'll stay, yes, I'll stay right here. I'll sing like there's nobody listening but you. And I'll dance like there's nobody watching but you. I'll worship with my last breath. Give my all till there's nothing left. My focus is you. Jesus, you are my center. My hope, my treasures are found in you. And I'll sing your praise.
You can build your home on my worship. I'll stay right here where I'm welcomed. You can build your home on my worship. I'll stay, yes, I'll stay right here. Say,
I'll stay right here where I'm welcome. You can build your
Wrap me in your arms.
closer than I've ever been. Draw me close, closer than before, closer than I've ever been. Lift up your voice, sing, draw me. Closer than I've ever been. Lord, we need you. Draw me close, closer than I ever been.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Draw us closer this morning, God. Draw us closer to you this morning, God. He who rests in the shadow of the Almighty, the Word of God says. Oh God, I pray this morning that each and every single one of us would abide in you, God. Be one with you in your presence, God. Let your Spirit, God, let your Spirit dwell in our hearts. Oh God, let your Spirit dwell in our minds this morning. Oh God, fill us this morning, God, to the overflow, God. Oh God, I pray this morning, God, that we would find refuge in you, God, this morning. Let us find shelter in you, God, this morning. Oh God, we come before you, God. We bow before you on bended knee this morning, God. And oh God, we pray right now you will cover us, God, with your feathers this morning in the name of Jesus. Oh God, we need a fresh touch from you this morning. Send a fresh wind upon your people this morning, God, in the name of Jesus. Oh God, I pray this morning for your people in this building, for the people under the sound of my voice this morning. Oh God, I pray they would give you their lives before you this morning, God. Oh God, I pray right now, God, for those that feel heavy burden, for those that feel outcasted this morning, for those that feel downtrodden this morning, for those that feel weary this morning. Our God, he still sees us. His name is Elroy, the God who sees us. He's a pillar of cloud by day. He's a pillar of fire by night. He leads us through valleys. He leads us through murky waters. He leads us at all times. And oh God, right now, oh God, I pray with your people who are here with our hands lifted high and our voices raised to you. Oh God, we praise you this morning. We praise you with everything inside of us this morning, God. Our souls this morning make their boast in you this morning, Lord Father. Oh God, I pray this morning, God, as we continue to lift you up, God. Oh God, let the demons run and flee at the sound of the name of Jesus this morning. The name of Jesus that has the power to change lives, that has the power, oh, to overturn battles, that has the power to lift us up when we feel weaker, that has the power to send the change to this morning, God. Send the change to your people, God. Let your word go through every nook and every cranny till each and every single tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Every knee shall bow, the word of God says. Every knee shall bow. Oh God, we bow before you this morning. There's nothing else left in us this morning, God, but we give you each and every single portion of us, God. We come before you this morning as broken vessels. And oh God, you are the potter. And let us be your clay this morning, God. Make us and mold us and use us, God, as instruments of your glory, as instruments of your will this morning. Oh God, let loose the shackles on our feet this morning. Oh God, open the jail cell this morning. Let our praise be uninhibited this morning. Put on your garment of praise this morning. In the atmosphere of heaviness, the word of God says to put on your garment of praise. I don't know what you've been through this week. I don't know what battle you had to overcome. But God is greater. God is mightier. God is more powerful than anything you could ask or think. He can do exceedingly and abundantly more than you can ask and more than you can think. He can make the impossible possible, the unfathomable fathomable. He is your protector, your healer, your Lord, your master, your savior, your redeemer, your deliverer. Hallelujah.
Our deliverer is here. He is here. Let your spirit move. Let your spirit move through your people this morning, God. We give you praise, Father, for all that you've done and all that you're going to do in the lives of your people. In the name of Jesus, amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let the earth be filled. Let the earth be filled this morning with the glory of God. Let the earth be filled. Your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And God, right now, you see your people throughout the world and you see what's going on right now in St. Vincent and the Grenadines. Oh God, we pray for your people there this morning. Let your mighty hand stay upon your people. Let them not wane nor weaken. But oh God, let them go forth emboldened, knowing that you are working all things together for their good right now. I pray for those that might have lost their homes there, for those that might be struggling with their faith right now, asking why. Oh God, you are the answer, God. You are the answer, God. And oh God, you will provide for your people. So we pray right now, God. Oh God, your name will be glorified in that island nation this morning, God. Oh God, nothing, God, shall stop them from praising you this morning, God. Oh God, we pray, God, for the aid that shall be sent there, God. Oh God, we pray that it will come in a timely manner, God, in the name of Jesus. We lift up our churches there this morning. We lift up both of our churches there this morning, God, and just say, have your way in the lives of the members, the lives of the pastor, God, there, in the name of Jesus. And oh God, we lift up GBP Ministries this morning, worldwide, throughout the earth, God. Oh God, we pray for each and every single pastor and minister this morning that shall be giving the word. Oh God, send a fresh touch upon them this morning, God, in the name of Jesus. Oh God, I pray that the word will come directly from you. Let them decrease, God, this morning, and you increase in their lives in the name of Jesus. And we lift up our pastor this morning to you, God. We thank you for his life, God. We ask this morning, God, you will continue, God, to uphold him, God, by your righteous right hand in the name of Jesus. I pray, God, he would stay on the straight and narrow path, God. I pray, God, that each and every single one of us, God, will continue to lean on him and lean onto you, God. I pray, God, that as he continues to guide us, God, that each and every single one of us would have our hearts open and ready to receive the word of God from the man this morning. And oh God, we pray right now, God. Oh God, for those that might need a healing touch from you. For those that might have heartaches and backaches and pains of all sorts. Oh God, we bring them before you this morning. Jehovah Rapha, our healer. Oh God, even if it might seem it's not working, we know, God, that you're working it out for our good. And we know you're working things out in our favor. So God, we come before you, God. And oh God, we pray, God, for divine healing this morning, God, in your people. In the name of Jesus. We lift up, God, each and every single youth, each and every single child this morning, God. Oh God, we pray they wouldn't follow paths of earthly wisdom, but they would follow you, God. They would grow up in your house, God. They would dwell with you. They would abide in you, God, in the name of Jesus. Oh God, we sing the song. You are the vine. Let us be the branches this morning, God, in the name of Jesus. I pray this morning, God. Oh God, that this service goes according to your will and according to your plan this morning, God. Oh God, I pray right now, God. Oh God, that those that might have come in with all types of preoccupations and dispositions, oh God, you would clear their mind and be able to receive the word of God from you this morning, God. Oh God, fix our minds and fix our thoughts on spiritual and heavenly things this morning. Take us in, God, to the Holy of Holies, past the brazen altar, past the priest who sing your praise this morning. We pray this morning, God. Oh God, as we come before you, God, oh God, we look to the heavens, knowing that all of our help, it comes from you and from you alone. For you are holy, 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 holy is the Lord God Almighty. Oh God, I pray this morning, God, you will pour out a new blessing upon your people. Let it rain right now, God, in the name of Jesus. Let it shower with new blessings this morning, God, in the name of Jesus. Oh God, we give you all praise, all glory, all honor, dominion, and power. It is yours forever and evermore. Amen. Amen. And amen.
Hallelujah. Come on and clap your hands. Give a God a shout of praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Proverbs, the 22nd chapter, verse 9 says, he or she who is generous will be blessed, for he gives some of his food to the poor. We know we are a tither. God has commanded us to tithe, amen, to give him back what he is due to him. He provides us employment, provides us opportunities to do well. But even in this time, we want to think about those in St. Vincent, and we want to thank you for answering the call. Come on and give God some praise. We see how overnight a volcano can erupt and just change all the perspective, all the plans that an island would have had. You think about our country, everything that we had planned last year, and then a pandemic came and changed all of that. But we serve a God who knows, who sits on the throne. And above all, he knows he has our back. And so our ability to respond to the call, this is what God is saying. For he gives of his bread to the poor, to those who are downcast, and those who are facing turmoils, trials, storms, volcanoes. You will be blessed for responding to the call. So I encourage you, as you tithe, as you give, as you're generous to those who are less fortunate, know your labor, your seed, your gift, your love will not go unanswered. Amen. Those at home and those in the sanctuary, pay attention to your screen at this time.
Welcome to God's Battalion of Prayer Church. You have the opportunity to give via cell phone. Text the number 73256, and in the subject line, type in GBP661. Click on the link that appears. It is secure and personalized. Type in the amount of money you would like to give, then select which fund you would like to give it to. Now it's time to enter your payment method. Now, click Give. Your gift has been sent. You're all set. Text Giving will save your payment method for future use and send you your receipt number. Thank you for being a blessing.
Amen. Those at home and watching on television, you can follow the barcode if you're having difficulty on your smartphones, and they'll give you the opportunity to text to give. And those in the sanctuary, you're able to do the same. We encourage you, those who have checks and cash, those who still do that, we encourage you on your way out to place it in the basket on your exit. Would you stand with me as we do our declaration together? Precious Father, thank you for the opportunity to earn an income from which I bring my tithes and offering. Upon the authority of your word, I have given, and it shall be given to me, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. I am a tither. I bring my tithe today into your storehouse. Therefore, the enemy is rebuked for my sake, and every curse is broken. I live under an open heaven. You pour upon me blessings that there is not enough room to receive it. We receive jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, sales and commissions, benefits and settlements, estates and inheritances, interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, bills paid off, debts demolished, and royalties received. My whole family is saved and walking with God. Now walk in perfect health, abundance, and divine favor. I am blessed going in. I am blessed going out. All that I do prospers in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. God bless you.
Thorns on thy brow.
lifted up from the earth, I'll draw men unto thee. Lift him up, lift him up. Still he speaks from eternity. He said,
he's risen. Okay. All right. Bless the Lord. Now let's turn to the word of the Lord. Acts chapter 1, from verse 1 to verse 6 is our scripture reading this morning. The first account I composed, Theophilus, about all that Jesus began to do and teach, until the day he was taken up, after he had by the Holy Spirit given orders to the apostles whom he had chosen. To these he also presented himself alive after his suffering, by many convincing proofs, appearing to them for a period of 40 days, and speaking of the things concerning the kingdom of God. And gathering them together, he commanded them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait for what the Father had promised when he said, "You heard of from me. For John baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now." And so when they had come together, they were asking him, saying, "Lord, is it at this time you are restoring the kingdom of Israel?" Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, that at this season, as we have just celebrated the resurrection, and we know, Lord God, that you spent 40 days upon the earth in preparation, making sure that those you had discipled, that those you had called and said to them, you were calling them that they to make them into fishers of men. You were now reminding them of why you had called them and why they were with you for 3 years. Father, I pray that your word will so challenge our hearts that we'll be conscious of who we are and whose we are. Your calling upon our lives even before we were conceived in our mother's womb. So we pray that you'll bless your word to our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. Bless the Lord. You may be seated. Title of today's message is Before Pentecost. Before Pentecost. Between the resurrection and Pentecost, it was very important that Jesus had put some things in place. He was doing, in the process of doing that for 3 years. And so at this juncture, he was, as it were, reassessing what he had done for 3 years. And if the people that he had following him and that he had ate with and slept with and taught and done all of that, if they really had come to the place that he could now go back to the Father, knowing that he had a team in place that will fulfill the Father's will. And so that's what our text is about this morning. And so as our sister was doing the drawing there, as the worship team was singing, and I was thinking, you know, of looking at her and taking the time and bringing forth the portrait that she has developed during that time. He reigns. And I could not be more appropriate for this message than for this portrait that we just saw. He reigns. Yes, let's give the Lord a hand. Now, I know she didn't know what I'm preaching on today, but it goes to remind us of the workings of the Holy Spirit in his body, in his church, in all of our lives, as we might not even be conscious. And here is this young lady doing this portrait. He reigns. And that's what our text really is bringing us to begin to understand that he must reign in our lives in the here and now, if he is to reign in our lives in the there and then. And so before Pentecost, and my theme is why preparation leads to fulfillment of purpose. Why preparation leads to fulfillment of purpose. You know, Friday night I was looking at the youth service, and when I'm looking at service, I am into the service. You know, so when they, I think it was a minister, my grandson said, let's lift our hands and praise the Lord, you know. I was in there. I was saying, but then I looked at the chat, and I saw our sister Sylvia Lopez sent greetings. And Sister Sylvia was a dedicated member of this congregation when she lived here in New York. And so she just lost her husband. And I know she is going through that period. And so it was good to see her sending greetings on the chat on Friday night in the youth service. So let's keep her in our prayers. The death of her husband was a sudden situation, but God is faithful. So we need to keep one another in prayer. All right. And so our text is, why preparation leads to fulfillment of purpose. And this is very important that we understand this, because what we do every day of our lives is determining this our purpose, if we are fulfilling our purpose, and what our reward will be when we stand before the one who reigns supreme. And so Corinthians tells us that he will reign forever and ever. And so we are looking at four important points as it relates to this message, why preparation leads to fulfillment of purpose. And so when we stand before him, if we are to hear him say, well done, thou good and faithful servant, it means that we are seeking to fulfill the will of God in our lives and through our lives. And so in this text, it says, the first account I composed, Theophilus, about all that Jesus began to do and teach. Jesus began to do and teach. Now, in this account of Theophilus, it gives us also a time that Jesus had to do and to teach, so that after he would go to the cross, and then he will go back to the Father and be seated at the Father's right hand, that the kingdom of God must be fulfilled upon the earth through those people that he engaged for 3 years. So there was a time limit that Jesus had to ensure that these men that he had chosen and he was going and living with and eating with and sleeping with for 3 years, that now he's going back to the Father, he can go back to the Father with the confidence that the kingdom of God will be established upon the earth. And in the fullness of time, when he returns as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, he will be able to have a kingdom that he will present to his Father at that time. So it was very important for Jesus, these 3 years that he spent with his disciples. I submit to you today that is very important. From the time that you were conceived in your mother's womb, that God knew you and knew me. And he said in his word that he has ordained our boundaries and he has established our boundaries. So therefore, wherever we are at this moment is in keeping with the plan of God. And so we are responsible, we are accountable to God that we fulfill his plan in our lives, so that at that time we can hear him say, well done, because we have indeed fulfilled our purpose upon the earth. Are you with me? Good. So Jesus had 3 years to develop these 11 men. There were 12 of them, but one, you know, Judas, was no more. To develop these 11 men so that when the time came for him to leave, he could not stay a day longer. When the time had come for him to leave, he left. And so it was Now the disciples that he had discipled that had to fulfill the purpose for which he had called them. And so here is Luke recording of all that Jesus began to do and to teach. Now, when we read this portion of scripture, these are two words that really captivate our attention. Jesus began to do and to teach. Now, when you look at the word to do, in the Greek, the word poleo is to model what a person desires another person to become. That's what the word in the original, when Jesus began to do, is that Jesus was modeling a life that he wanted his disciples to become. When he called him, he said, "Follow me, and I will make you to become fishers of men." So Jesus spent 3 years discipling 12 men that they will become fishers of men. And so Jesus began to do. In other words, he began to live a life in keeping with his purpose. So the Bible tells us that after he had defeated Satan on the Mount of in the wilderness, the next thing he did is that he knew his time had come for him to begin his ministry, and he went up to Galilee, where according to prophecy, and that's why we need to understand the importance of every prophet, every prophecy that we read in the Old Testament, because it had to be fulfilled in the New Testament. And so Jesus left the wilderness, and he went along the seashore, and he saw these men that he began to call them to follow him, because he knew that his reason for being here is not only to take on Satan head on, but also to develop men to fulfill the purpose of the Father, to develop a kingdom for the Father. In other words, what was put on hold in the Garden of Eden, Jesus came to make sure that that garden comes back into being. And that's what the church is all about, to create the habitation of the Father. And so Jesus began to teach them. And not only he was teaching them, not only he was modeling, but also he was teaching them. And one may ask, what is the difference between doing and teaching? Well, there's a major difference. To do is to model. And to teach is the science of what you're doing. In other words, we need to understand that it's not enough to say to someone, be a witness. It's to teach them what being a witness is all about. It is to make sure that they understand why you did what you did, or why you do what you do. When Jesus was there in the upper room before he went to the garden and he had that last meal with his disciples, the Bible says that he girded himself with a towel and began to wash. They took a basin with water and began to wash their feet. Now, we read this account several times, but how many of us have ever asked ourselves, how come Jesus was able to wash their feet? In terms of not just the physical, but Jesus went there prepared to model or to teach the lesson of love. And so to do that, he made sure that he guarded himself with a towel, an appropriate piece of garment that he can use to wash their feet and to wipe it. And so as we, as believers, We must not wake up every day and just go through the day doing the things that we are accustomed doing. We must ask ourselves, what will God have me do today? What do I need to have with me as I go to work, as I go to school, or whatever I'm doing today? Am I prepared to fulfill my purpose? Is there a situation that I will come in contact with that I need to be prepared for? What is that the Holy Spirit will say to me today to do differently than I did yesterday or accustomed doing? Do I live with the understanding that I am the child, I am a servant of the king, and the king's business requires haste, so therefore I need to question my day as I seek God for keeping me, and I thanking him for keeping me during the night and waking me up and setting me on my way. What is my day going to be like? Now, somebody said just now, a little while ago, about we had plans last year, but nobody saw COVID coming and neutralized all our plans. And Minister Al, about the people in St. Vincent, did not expect this volcano to come and disrupt all the plans that they had. And so it is that we don't know what will happen from one day to the next, but our God knows. And so he wants to always prepare us to deal with whatever situation he permits to come along our path, because he has a will, he has a purpose. And so Jesus, in these 40 days between resurrection and going back to the Father, he now had to make sure that what he had done for 3 years with these men have really accomplished, or is really at the place where he can now go with the confidence that what he had done will accomplish the will of the Father. And so we as believers, the thing about being a witness is not just to share a tract or to say a word or quote a scripture verse. It's to make sure that this person that we are witnessing to is able to become a person like myself. In other words, you know, as I saw Sister Sylvia on the chat Friday night, I immediately, you know, went back to when she started coming and to battalion, and, you know, even though she was living all the way in Long Island, she was here on time for service. And whatever she offered to do, she did. And so we must understand how important our lives is in the kingdom of God. We must not go through the motion, well, I'm saved, I'm going to heaven, and so I'm just coasting along, you know, I'm just doing what I believe God will be happy with. But that's not where Jesus was. He recognized that the 3 years that he spent here would have been of little value if, when he had gone back to the Father, the church could not move on with the coming of the Holy Spirit. So he was making sure in those final 40 days that his disciples understood why they were with him. He was making sure that they were now set to move forward and to build the church of Jesus Christ. And so Jesus prayed in John 17. He said, not only for these that I'm praying for, but I'm praying for them and all those who will hear what they have to say. So in other words, the disciples became the bridge between God the Father and God the Son. And you and I are the bridge between the persons that God used to bring us the Word of God and to bring us into the kingdom, and those who will come in as a result of our faithfulness to God. Amen. And so when I think of my responsibility, and I think of that man that took the time, and even though it was not that much time, but the time that we spent together was so important. On my way to work, I stopped by his home, and he'll take me down to his basement, and we'll sit and chat, and talk about ministry, and talk about the faithfulness of God, and how God led him, and how when he had come to a point where he was, as it were, dumbfounded to know that the same organization that led him to the Lord in Barbados, now he come to America, and the same organization, church, says, we can't accept you because of the color of your skin. And what it was like for him at that moment. Could have gone the negative way. Could have given up on church and said, this whole thing is a farce. Because these people came to my island and tell me about the love of God. And now I come here and I'm not accepted among them. But no, he went on his knees and get the mind of God. And that's why we're here today. And so we need to be faithful so that others will come after to understand who God is and to serve him in spirit and in truth. So to do is to model, to show, to demonstrate. What people need to do. So when we are witnessing to people, we must make sure that they can see from our lives what they are supposed to become. That's what Jesus did. In other words, they lived with him, they ate with him, they slept with him. They saw his every move. There was nothing that Jesus ever did that the disciples were disappointed in Jesus. And that's what our responsibility is. Ought to be. And so Jesus, both what Jesus began to do and to teach. The word for do is paleo, the word for teach is dasko. It is to influence the understanding of the one that is being taught. In other words, when Jesus, as I said, Jesus decided to wash the disciples' feet. And Peter said, you don't never wash my feet. Jesus said to him, if I don't wash your feet, you're not a part of me. And Peter went to the other extreme. Well, not only my feet, but give me a complete bath. Jesus said, no, no, no. In other words, he was saying to Jesus really did not know what he was all about. So if you can't wash my feet, then bathe me. That's what Peter's thinking. But Jesus knew exactly what he was doing. And so we must be confident of our relationship with Almighty God, that we can model the life of God to those that we come in contact with, whether it's at work or whether it's at school, whether it's in our own families. They must see Christ in us. They must be able to say whatever they do. You know, one of the things that, you know, a couple weeks ago when I was down in Guyana, and I went to visit both of my adopted sisters that are alive. And all we talked about is the blessings that we receive from a man who was a total stranger to us until we were adopted into his home. But we saw him 24 hours a day, practically. Living the life of Christ, seeing the hand of God, seeing his laying hands on the sick and they're recovering, seeing his prophetic words and they come to pass. And we would also conclude, it does not matter what we do, none of us that had that opportunity could deny that we've been blessed. And so each of us must make it our daily moment by moment question. Am I fulfilling my purpose? It's not just a matter of going through the ritual. Say, yes, I came to church. But what did I receive today, and what will what I receive today do for me or do through me this week? So Jesus began to do and to teach. Next thing we find in this text, in verse 3, it says, to these he also presented himself alive. In other words, here are these men living with Jesus for 3 years. Jesus has gone to the cross. He's crucified. He's buried. He rose from the grave and rose from the dead. And he appeared to them the said day, 8 days later, with Thomas in the midst. And Luke catches the vision of Jesus, every move of Jesus during these 40 days. To these he also presented himself alive after his suffering, by many convincing proofs appearing to them over a period of 40 days. So Jesus understood the importance of spending the time and the way he spent the time with them, for them to be firmly convinced in their hearts. Because he knew if they were not convinced in their hearts that he was Christ risen from the dead. In other words, he appeared to them when they were locked up in the room the said day. Then he came back 8 days later, he appeared to them. Then he said to them, meet me in Galilee. They went there, they went fishing. Jesus allowed them to prove to themselves that they really were not at the place where they should have been. If they were at the place where they should have been, they would have never listened to Peter when he said, I go fishing. They would have stayed at the mountain, at the appointed place, and waited for Jesus. And so Jesus knew at that point that, listen, these guys really are not at the place where they should be. And so as Christians, we need to make sure, we have the responsibility to make sure that people understand exactly where they need to be in Christ. We must not just take it for granted. Well, yes, you know, I prayed with them, I read the scripture with them. No, but we must take the responsibility because they are our disciples to make. And we will be rewarded based upon those that make it into the kingdom. Jesus said that day, I would say to many, Lord, who would say to me, Lord, did we not do this in your name or do that in your name? And he would say, I never knew you. So it's important for us to understand, to focus on the vision for which God has called us. Now, as I'm meditating on this and I'm thinking about me and I'm thinking about my family, and I'm thinking about the church. And so I decided, let me look at our mission statement. Why we exist, who we are, our mission, why we exist. And so our mission statement says, our mission is to transform the community as our members grow in faith, fellowship, character, commitment in ministry and missions. And I said, wow, wow, wow. If this is our mission, then it means that our lives are living out our purpose. Are you there? Our mission to transform the community as our members grow in faith, fellowship, character, commitment in ministry and missions. That's who we are supposed to be. In other words, our every waking moment should be growing in faith. In other words, when we read the Word of God, we're not just fulfilling a, what's the word I'm looking for? A ritual. But rather, how does this impact my faith? Every time I read the Word of God, how do I see my faith being strengthened? Grow in faith, fellowship. How many of us, when we don't see somebody, pick up the phone and make an investigation? I walked in the office Wednesday. As I was sitting down, the phone rang. And it was a sister that I was thinking about and planned to either call her or to ask somebody that I know she's close with. How is she doing? She was on the phone. Pastor, I'm calling because I need prayers. Now, if the phone had rang and went to voicemail, it would have said to her, don't leave a message because I'm not here every day. But get to one of the other extensions that if it's an emergency, they can get to me. So I'm looking at what we say to the world. When they go on the website, they see that our mission is to transform the community as our members grow in faith, fellowship. How many of us see the importance of fellowship one with the other? I was out of the country when I got the text or the email, whatever, that Mother Ford will be 90. And so I replied, I would love to be a part if I will be granted the opportunity to share, even though I am not at home. And so the message came back, of course. So, lest I forget, I said, please send me another email the day before. Help me help myself. So that people are not from Barbados and America and different places waiting for me to come on and I'm doing something else. But remind me, help me. I'm getting younger, so I need to help. Grow in faith, fellowship, character, commitment in ministry. Now, Pastor Smith is out there, just his family in Cahokia, Illinois. And he has just given me the dates that he would love for some help to come, which is July 11th to the 16th. Now, when I spoke with the men last month, I didn't get the feeling like too many men was interested in going. So when I'm looking at our mission statement, our mission is to transform the community as our members grow in faith, fellowship, character, commitment in ministry, and missions. How committed are we to say, well, even though it might be challenging, but nobody stopped going to the food store. People still going to the malls. People still going everywhere. What about us as God's disciples? How committed are we to our mission statement? I challenge you, take a fresh look at our mission statement. If each of us look at our mission statement and begin to say to ourselves, this is who I am becoming. This is who I am working to become. According to our mission statement, this should be my life. If each of us began on this path to make this a reality in each of our lives, this building will be too small in the very near future. Are you there? Amen. If this becomes our desire and we begin to work towards this, every director will be bombarded because here are people who want to get busy for Jesus. The reason why we have not yet begin to operate at the place where we should is because we are not conscious of what we're supposed to become. In other words, there's no message that we can hear that will be greater than this vision statement, mission statement. If each of us put this into practice in our lives, we don't need any preacher to come and tell us how to live. This is right here. To these he also presented himself alive after his suffering, by many convincing proofs, appearing to them over a period of 40 days and speaking of the things concerning the kingdom of God. After his suffering. So many times with minor inconveniences, we put our arms down. And so focus on the vision of the kingdom of God. Being an example of the kingdom. That's what our mission statement is all about. Making sure that each director makes sure that the team understands their importance by going the extra mile. In other words, even as directors and as deacons of head of departments or whatever, all of us must take the responsibility of being the example of what we want our team members to become. We are modeling. We must model for them what they need to be. And if they begin to emulate us as leaders, then we will not have a difficult time seeing the will of God being done. Because everybody will be in the same mode. So in addition to our mission statement, we have vision statement, global evangelism and discipleship. Well, if we are doing our mission statement, automatically our evangelism and discipleship will be in the place where it should be. And then our core values as a church, the following are the values we hold, which form the foundation for what we do, whose we are, and how we conduct ourselves. All of that will be manifested if we fulfill our mission statement. Jesus began to do and to teach. To these he also presented himself alive after suffering by many convincing proofs. We have got to convince the world out there that we are for real. We've got to convince the world out there that the God in us loves them, cares for them, and that we are his conduit to help them to know him and to serve him in spirit and in truth. We are the models. So gathering them together, final instruction, Jesus, verse 4. And gathering them together, he commanded them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait for what the Father had promised, which he said, you heard of from me. The reason why discipleship is a long-term process is because people will forget what you said to them. And even though you might model it, they'll forget the importance. They forget the science of why you do what you do. When Jesus took that bowl with water and washed his disciples' feet, if Jesus had just said to them, you need to love one another as I have loved you, they would have forgotten that the next day when they saw him arrested. But because he did what he did with that bowl of water and that towel, even when Peter denied him, he was thinking about that experience with Jesus and Jesus washing his feet. The only person that was not there throughout the feet washing service was Judas. But that feet washing experience that night serves as a lesson throughout all the generations until Jesus returns. If it's one thing everybody remembers about that night, is the feet washing. It's indelibly printed in our hearts and in our minds. And some denominations make it one of their standing rituals. They have feet washing service. I'm not about to go down that road, but we need to so live. Those things that the Holy Spirit might direct us to do to make a lasting impression on that person that we're discipling, on that person that we're witnessing to, on that person that we're living next to, or we go to school with, or we go to work with. Might be a little thing. To you, it might be insignificant. But the Holy Spirit knows that that little thing is just like, for most of us, there's one little thing somebody did that made a difference in our lives. Amen. So gathering them together for final instructions, the importance of being in the right place. He said to them, I'm reminding you that whatever you do, after I'm gone, go back to Jerusalem and wait. He knew waiting was a difficult thing for them. They had just demonstrated it. They were supposed to go to Galilee and wait for him. They went fishing. And so he's reiterating in their hearts and in their minds. Don't leave Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father. The Bible says about 500 of them were there. But after he was taken up, How many obeyed? Less than one third obeyed him and went to the upper room and waited. The rest went on about their business. Don't ever believe that because you give someone a tract or you witness to someone or you invited them to church, that that's enough. Making disciples is a long-term process. It's a process that involves your being uncomfortable or made to feel even little. When you relate that, when you compare that with Jesus going to the cross, you know it's nothing. When somebody embarrasses you or somebody says something that you don't like, put that alongside Jesus being on the cross and then come up with your motivation. That is nothing. I can endure that and move on for the glory of God. So he gathered them together. Final instruction. The importance of being in the right place. And there are some places that we need to be at. They're strategic for the accomplishing of God's will. For Saul, it was on the road to Damascus. That's where God chose to confront him, on the road to Damascus. So Jerusalem was the place for them to be. Out of that 500, all those who did not obey Jesus and go to Jerusalem, they were out of the mix. They were not part of the will of God and the coming of the Holy Spirit to begin the church upon the face of the earth. They were outside of that because they did not believe what Jesus said to go and wait. To be an effective disciple of Jesus Christ, there are going to be some uncomfortable moments, some uncomfortable situations. But if you remember that we are a people who will transform our community, transform our world by growing in faith, fellowship, character, commitment in ministry and missions. If we can remember that, regardless of what the wind that blows, we will stay focused to our mission. And so as I move on, number four, final preparation. Remind them of the key points. For John baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. In other words, it was not just going to the upper room, at least for the 120 that obeyed, but to expect what is going to come. So that all the 120 knew that we are here because something that we don't understand is going to happen. And so until it happens, we are going to stay here. See, we need to understand this when we talk about prayer meeting, when we come to prayer meeting, and by the grace of God, I trust that we can begin to assemble back for prayer meeting. But we need to come with some understand purpose. What's our reason for being here tonight? Like Sister Archer, for example, we were at prayer meeting and we just closed the prayer meeting. We're getting ready to go home when her daughter went into crisis. And we all had to get back on our knees and cry out to God. And God touched her daughter and she walked out. Hallelujah. Healed and was never attacked by that sickness for many years, sickle cell. Jesus says, you shall receive, and again, not give them a specific time. You shall receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit not many days hence. He could have told them exactly when. He said, no, 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 you go there and wait. And so we need to understand these important truths. That if we are going to be successful disciples, we've got to be prepared to go for the long haul. For John baptized with water. Yes, that is already done. John, the man with the camel's hair and the leather belt, he did what he came to do. He fulfilled his purpose. It was only preparation for me coming after. So I baptized with water, but there is coming one after me whose shoes I'm not worthy to unloose. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. And so Jesus said, now is the time. Not many days hence. Go there and wait. And so when they had come together, they were asking him, saying, Lord, is it this time you are restoring the kingdom of Israel? Jesus just said, go to Jerusalem, wait for the promise that you heard of from me. John told you about it. I told you about it. Go there and wait. And where were their minds? Their minds were someplace else. They heard what Jesus said, but they did not hear what Jesus said, because they were focused on getting rid of the Romans. They were focused on the earthly kingdom. While Jesus was speaking about the kingdom of heaven coming to earth in the church, while the Holy Spirit coming to transform humanity into heavenly beings, they were still concerned about Jesus getting rid of the Romans. And so as believers, as disciples of Christ, it's more than going through the ritual. It's understanding, it's taking the time to understand where people are. Yes, you might have been counseling them for a couple of years or what have you, but it's our responsibility to find out where they are. Let's live with assumption that yes, I've been sharing with them for 10 years that they are now spiritually matured. No, we must find out by asking certain questions or listening to what they're saying. And from listening to what they're saying, you may understand that what you have said did not register. And that's what Jesus did. He said to them, go to Jerusalem and wait. And now he's listening back to them, to their response. And so when they had come together, they were asking him, saying, Lord, is it at this time you are restoring the kingdom to Israel? As I close today, it is my prayer that the Lord would help us to take a fresh look at our discipleship understanding. That we take a fresh look at our mission statement. And by the grace of God, that each of us must be able to say to ourselves, I am truly living out our mission statement. So that when we pray, We can challenge God and say, God, show me where I come short. Show me where I need to change. Show me what I need to do so that I can be that effective disciple that you want me to be, so that I can help to transform the community, so that I can help to transform this nation. Father, our Father, we humble ourselves before you today. Lord God, as we look at our mission statement, Lord, it is possible that we are nowhere close. But Lord, you said if we acknowledge our shortcomings, you are more than able to help us. So, Father, it's our desire to impact East Flatbush. It's our desire through this ministry that you have raised up, through a man who was at a crossroads when he was rejected by the organization that came to his country and told him that Jesus saves. And because of his faithfulness to you, you have brought us to be part of this body. And Lord, it's our desire that even after he has gone to be with you, this ministry still exists. Lord, so let it be, should Jesus tarry, that those of us who are here this morning, that through our commitment and through our determination, this ministry will fulfill its purpose, that East Flatbush will not remain the same. But Lord, transformation will come, revival will come to this community, that people across this city, across this state and nation, you will be glorified because of us that you have brought into this ministry, even at this time. This is our prayer, Lord. And because in our humanity, we are weak, but in our divinity, you are Lord. You reign. Reign in our hearts. Reign in our lives. And make us the people that you desire us to be. It's our prayer in the name of the Lord Jesus. If you're here today, you do not know Jesus Christ as your Savior, and it's your desire to be the child of God that God wants you to be, if you will call upon him, he will hear you, he will save you, and he will fill you with his Holy Spirit and make you an instrument of his kingdom. And so if you do not know Jesus, I'd ask you to repeat this prayer after me as we call upon the Lord, because he is faithful and just. To everyone that call upon him, he will answer. Repeat after me, Lord Jesus, I desire to be the person you have brought me to this planet to be. I do not understand it all, but by faith, I give you my life. I give you my heart. Take me as I am. Let your Holy Spirit come and dwell within me. Change me and make me an instrument of your kingdom. It's my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Come on, let's bless the Lord for the word of the Lord today. Amen. Give God praise for those who are watching at home. If you are a visitor, we encourage you to scan the barcode. Give us your information so we can be in contact with you. Amen. And please reach out in the chat. We have members who are watching. We will respond to you. Amen. Amen. Come on and clap your hands again. Give the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. For that power of the Holy Spirit. That Holy Spirit that nudges, that leads us. Amen. We give God praise for it. I want you to remember all those who are sick and shut in. Those at home bound, those in nursing homes, please give them a call, visit, check in on them at this time. Amen. Also, those who were not able to participate in tithes and offering, you can scan the barcode and text to give at home. This afternoon at 4 o'clock, we have our members meeting. Members meeting, I'm going to take a few minutes so you can write down the barcode. It's also on the bulletin. If you were able to get it on the email Mr. Pascal sent out, that's the Zoom meeting ID. All you need is the meeting ID, and you'll be let in. Amen? That is 4 o'clock. All members, we encourage you to please be on the Zoom this afternoon. Because of the pandemic, we have not had a business meeting, and we want to do that this afternoon. Amen? We, as our pastor just announced about Cahokia, we're going to have an outreach. And that'll be from July the 11th, that's a Sunday, to the 17th. Amen. We want to go out and be a blessing to the Cahokia, Illinois. It's East St. Louis, and that is the dates. Please, if you're interested in bringing items, we're still collecting items. We've sent out some barrels already to St. Vincent. But we'll be sending some more, so you can please bring items, flashlights, batteries, underwear, clothing, towels, footwear, blankets, transistor radios, first aid. Not old clothes. Let me say it again. Do not try to clear out your closet and bring it here for us to send it. We will not send that, so don't bring it. Amen? We want to send them new things. Brand new things. So please do your very best to do that. Supply food items, dry foods, canned meat, and good cereals. Amen. I'm going to have Brother Gabriel come this time. Let's bless the Lord for him.
Good morning, church. How are y'all doing? Amen. 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 I want to take this time to speak to you guys a little bit about what's been going on in the youth department. Our youth participated in fine arts this year. It wasn't in Syracuse like it normally is. It was virtual, but we had 11 youth that competed, and they all did absolutely amazing. Just give them a round of applause at this time. They did a fantastic job, each and every single one of them, and you'll be seeing them more and more involved in service as we go along the way and we approach the National Festival. But of the 11 there, you see their names. Sister Shania Williams did a vocal solo, and she received an excellent rating. Give her a round of applause. Sister Katrina Alexis did a dance solo, beautiful dance solo. She received an excellent rating as well. Sister Cleopatra Bonnie did a female vocal solo as well, and she received an excellent rating as well. So give her a round of applause. And then we have 7 youth that will be proceeding to the National Festival, which will be held in Orlando in August. And those folks are Samara Davis, who did a female vocal solo. She received a superior with invitation. Brendan Forte, who you saw last month on Youth Sunday with the spoken word, he proceeded not only in spoken word, but short sermon as well, superior with invitation, so give him a round of applause. Malachi Patton, who works upstairs, you can't see him right now, but he's up there. He did graphic design, superior with invitation. Congratulations to Malachi. Samuel Smith, those of you that know Sister Maxwell's grandson, he did a rap solo, superior with invitation. Malachi Kingston did a dance solo, superior with invitation as well. Give him a round of applause. Jewel Isaac had a visual art, two-dimensional, superior with invitation as well, going to nationals. And last but not least, our brother Micah Springer, who unfortunately isn't here today, not only did he proceed to nationals, he won the district festival in piano solo. So give Micah a round of applause and give all these youth a round of applause. We, Brother Marlon and myself, are so overjoyed with what they were able to do in the midst of these circumstances. You'll be seeing them a lot more as we proceed on, as we head to nationals in Orlando. I would like to say, last but not least, everybody's been wondering when we're coming back on Friday nights. I promise you we'll be back sooner than later. So thank each and every single one of you. Have a blessed morning. I'll turn it back over to Minister Alfred.
Amen. We give God praise for our youth going to Orlando. Amen. So many of you in your time of television and social media know that we are in the midst of an election cycle. Now, most people pay more attention to the presidential election, which is very important. But your municipalities, your local elections are so, so important. And so we have a young lady who has been a blessing through the governor and lieutenant governor's office as to our church. She is now running for the city council in Canarsie, Georgetown, New Basin, Gerritsen Beach, Sheepshead Bay. So Canarsie would be the eastern part, and Sheepshead Bay would be the western part. Would you put your hands together? She's a woman of faith. Shirley Paul Esquire, she goes to New Hope. Pastor Stevenson, a good friend of mine. Let's come on, let's put our hands and welcome her.
Thank you. Praise God. It is so good to be in the house of the Lord with my brothers and sisters in Christ. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Cockfield, First Lady Lynette Cockfield. I thank you. I thank you for your service to the community and around the world. Minister Al Cockfield, I thank you for your service too and your friendship. And to everyone that comes together to make this happen, from all the teams, I know it's a lot of work that goes into it, and I thank you too. As Minister Cockfield said, my name is Shirley Paul. I'm a candidate for New York City Council in District 46 here in Brooklyn, stretching from Canarsie going to Sheepshead Bay. I am honored to speak before you today as a woman of God. I know that it is important what we invite into our spaces where we worship. So it is a blessing to be with you here. And as I'm here, I'm just so thankful and in continued awe of how good God is. I've worshiped with you here and in your Rockaway location. And most of those times I was accompanying either Governor Cuomo or Lieutenant Governor Hochul or a judge and asking you to support them. And today God has me before you asking you to support me. And this is an endeavor. I'm following God with all of it. As Minister Cockfield said, I work in government, I'm also an attorney. But I wanna marry those experiences of working in government, my love for the community, and of course, my faith, to have Holy Spirit-inspired strategy to fight food insecurity, housing, to just meet our needs. We're in a crisis where it's exposed the public health, things that we always knew were a problem in our communities, but now they're too big to sweep under the rug. So we need creative leadership, new leadership that can face those challenges and come with their faith. But you know, it's not an easy task, especially when you're walking with God in arenas that don't give God all the glory. So I'm asking you to tell your friends that live in Canarsie, Flatlands, Georgetown, Bergen Beach, Mill Basin, Mill Island, Marine Park, Gerritsen Beach, and Sheepshead Bay to stand with me to make me their number one pick this year on June 22nd. Early voting starts on June 12th through the 20th. If you don't live in those communities, tell your friends, but above all, keep me in prayer. I'm looking forward to coming back to worshiping with you again. And again, my name is Shirley Paul, New York City candidate for District 46. Thank you.
Amen. You all know that I'm very particular. If I make a call and they don't answer, when someone in the church has an issue or a need, then, you know, I know if you're not going to answer now, you're not going to answer when you get in office. Somebody say amen. Amen. It's very important that we support people who support us. People can't tell you they're going to do something if they never did something before. You can't believe their track record is going to change all of a sudden when they get in the seat. And so we must be attentive. Not all the commercials you see, everything you see is always what it is. People are concerned about their communities. I like to follow the money. And so we're going, Shirley Paul talked about ranked choice voting, I'm going to try to get us a demonstration on how do we do those ballots in June 22nd, because it's something that we've never done before. If you live in the Rockaways, you did it on the last special election a few months ago. We had a special election. We were first actually in the city to experience ranked choice voting. But especially our seniors who have never voted with ranked choice voting, I want to make sure we're educated, amen? That's right, come on, we give God some praise, because listen, people give their life not knowing who would benefit for us just to have the option to vote. There's some folks that come into our city and want to change the way we do things because they don't like too much black people in leadership. That's right, I said it. And so that's why they put this ranked choice voting, to kind of confuse you, because too many black people are becoming in senior leadership. So we must be attentive to what's going on. But I want to make sure we are aware. But what I do is I also follow the money. So when you look at donors, you can go on Campaign Finance Board. This is public knowledge. You can go on and see who donates to certain candidates. These candidates who, they have an agenda. A lot of you complained about our former president. But if you look at his donors, you can see who they're donating to in New York City. Because New York City is the capital of the country. The money that's made in New York takes care of the rest of the country. So we give God praise that we have our senior senator now over the states, the U.S. Senate. But there are people who are concerned about who gets elected in our city. So we make sure you be attentive to that. But I'm going to make sure we get a demonstration of how we, for this next ballot for June 22nd for ranked choice voting. Let's welcome back our pastor for the benediction. God bless you. Be well in the Lord. Enjoy your week. And please pay attention to the ushers on your exit.
Sister Noel, would you come up front and greet the church?
Can we bring a mic for her, please, quickly?
Is coming. Could we get some light up?
Good day, church.
Okay, come
God
to the light.
Is good.
Come a bit closer. Okay, good, so that we can see you.
God is good all the time.
Yes. Amen. Bless the Lord.
Now I'm here standing with a cane. On the 27th of June, I was not able to move. My right side was all dead. Woke up good that morning, went downstairs, wet some plants, head a box stairs, had some breakfast, and then I decided to do some work. Work making bread, banana bread and regular bread. But in the process doing that, I mix the flour, put it on the counter, ready to knead the dough. My right side wasn't able to do it. And I said, okay. I got to get to the dining table, crawl around the counter, and get there. There was a phone. But before I took the phone, I started saying, Jesus, Jesus, praying you to God and asking what is going on, what is wrong. And then I sat down, I picked up the phone and I called my brother. And he said to me, my sister-in-law is not at home right now, but he will call her. And in a few minutes, they were home at me. And he said to me, well, you said that if anything should happen to you, fly out of the country or leave you in the house until God takes me home. So I said, yes, I remember telling you that because of what happened to my older brother. And he said, well, you have to go to see a doctor. You have to go to the hospital. I said, well, okay. And he called his son from the garage. That was a Saturday. And the neighbor came, it's a police officer. And they took me, put me in the car, and then one of the doctor's office, doctor sent me to do a CAT scan, and then to be admitted at the hospital. And we did the CAT scan, and the Monday, the doctor came in and said to me, he said, you had a clot blood, you have a clot blood at the top of your left ear. So they treated me, and on the sixth day, they sent me home. And I was very, very happy to get home, although I couldn't walk. I was in the same position. But thank God, when I got home, two persons were there again to get me out of the car, get me into the house, in that bed. And my sister-in-law said to me, don't worry, we have someone to do day and night to take care of you. I give God all praise and thanks. I had planted some beans, some okras, and other things before, 2 weeks before. And during my stay at home, I was able to go down with a cane next to the house and pick me some okras and some beans. So God is good all the time. I give him praise, I give him thanks for everything he has done. In Jesus' name, amen.
Bless the Lord. We give God praise, amen. Good to see Sister Noel again back in New York, amen. Praise the Lord, hallelujah. Praise God. Let us pray. Our God and Father, we give you thanks and praise, glory and honor for your faithfulness. Lord, I thank you for your children, each one of them, their families. Lord, we pray that you would help us to be the people that will glorify you, not only in what we say, but what we do and how we live, and be that channel of blessing. In the name of Jesus, I pray that you bless your people, meet every need, and we pray for those, Lord, even at home, Lord God, you know their needs, you know their desires, but I pray, Father, that all of us, whether we're at home or in your house, will be the people that will glorify you. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Go with God, and he will go with you.